the associate minister at St. John Missionary Baptist Church, pastored by Sean Taylor. He attended Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary with a degree, a doctorate degree. He is a professor at the Southern Bible Institute. Give God some praise.
Call him.
Yes, yes.
So they called the blind man and said to him, "Have courage. Get up. He's calling for you." He threw off his coat, jumped up, and came to Jesus. Then Jesus answered him, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Rabboni, I want to," blind said, "I want to see. I want to recover my sight." Jesus said to him, "Go. Your faith has saved you," or "their faith has made you whole." Immediately, he could see and began to follow Jesus on the road.
Yes, yes.
If you don't mind today, I'm going to uplift a couple of ideas in the text. It said when he heard that Jesus of Nazareth was passing through, he cried out, he hollered. And when they told him to be quiet, he hollered even more. If you don't mind today, I want to speak to you from the subject, make you want to holler. You may be seated.
Amen.
Make you want to holler.
Yeah.
Rockets, moonshots, spend it all, the have-nots. Money, we make it. Before we see it, you take it. Make you want to holler the way they do my life. Inflation, no chance to receive finance. Bills pile up, sky high. Send that boy off to die. Crime, it's increasing. Trigger happy. Policing. Natural fact is, I can't pay my taxes. Marvin Gaye says, that'll make you want to holler and throw up both your hands. When he surveys the city, and he looks at the community. Marvin Gaye in the album Inner City Blues, he said, there are some things in life that just make you want to holler and throw up both your hands. When you survey what's going on in the city of Detroit, in the urban and inner city areas of major metropolitan cities, Marvin Gaye said, there are some things in life that give you the inner city blues and it'll make you want to holler. That was 1971. And even though that's in 1971, when you look at 2018, there are still some things that make you want to holler. When I look at the educational system, and kids acting a fool in educational system, and you see folks acting crazy, there's some things that'll make you want to holler. When you look at Charlottesville, and these people are marching with tiki torches, and then the president gets up and says, well, there's good people. In both groups, good people. There are some things that just make you want to holler. When you look at Sacramento and see that the brother in his own grandmother's backyard is shot 8 times in the back. There are some things that'll make you want to holler. Even in our communities where kids are being raised 75% of the time are raised in family with no father, single parent homes, that'll make you want to holler. But can I tell you, even though it's 2018, that'll make you want to holler. Even though we're in the time of Marvin Gaye in 1971, where there's some things that make you want to holler, I came to tell you, neither Tim Fuller, neither those at New St. Mark, Now, though that in 1971, there's somebody that I find out in the text that just does not want to holler, he does holler.
Oh, man. Yes, sir.
I like that.
And he hollers out.
Yes.
But can I tell you, one thing good about this man that hollers, he hollers at the right person, and he hollers the right thing. I wish I had y'all with me today. Because if we view this text today, we see this man by the name of Blind Bartimaeus. Can I just unpack it? I ain't gonna hold you too long today. I know y'all wanna go to Luby's or cafeteria, whatever y'all do, but can I just unpack this text today?
Yes, sir.
So y'all looking at me all cross-eyed, but whatever I say is gonna be in the text, so y'all gotta follow along with me. Is that all right?
Yes, sir.
Now this is gonna be in your Bible in case you ain't tore it out. Watch this. He says, watch this. The text says that Jesus is on his way to the cross. He's on his way to Jerusalem.
Uh-huh.
And while he's on his way to Jerusalem, the text says he stops by a city. He's passing through a city by the name of Jericho. Mm-hmm. And when he's passing through the city, the text says that he has some people with him that are called Passover pilgrims. In other words, it was their responsibility, and if you are 15 miles away from Jerusalem, it was your responsibility, if you were 12 years old and up, you were to go to Jerusalem at the time of the Passover. Some people couldn't make it, so what they would do is they would gather around in the villages and the cities along the streets and encourage those that are going.
Uh-huh.
And I wish I had time to unpack that because there's a lot of folk that are just bystanders when it comes to worship.
Yeah.
I wish I had somebody to help me. Yeah. You ain't going nowhere, but you want to, all you there just sit there on the sideline. I'll get you there in a second. Watch it. They're sitting waiting as these Passover pilgrims come through. The text says not only was it Jesus passing through, it was some followers, his disciples, and he also had some fans of the large crowd.
Uh-huh.
And can I tell you, in any group where Jesus is around, you're going to have, number one, you're going to have some fans.
Yeah.
And can I tell you, there's a lot of fans in churches, and they'll clap, but they won't follow. they'll give a little bit, but they won't follow. And in this text, they also have some fans of Jesus, but they also have some followers of Jesus. Uh-huh. Followers are his disciples, the fans are the large crowd.
All right.
See, the fans ain't going to Jerusalem. They'll just encourage you as you go. Watch this. He comes through there, and the text says, there's a fella that, watch this, he's blind, he's begging, and he's by the wayside.
Yeah.
Can I just unpack that for you?
Yeah.
The text says that there's a man, his name is Bartimaeus, the only blind man named in Scripture.
Uh-huh.
All other old blind folk don't have no name. And Mark, he doesn't have a name. And John, he doesn't have a name. But this text, Mark, for some reason, lets us know that his name is Bartimaeus.
Yeah.
He's blind, he's begging, and he's by the wayside. This man got a problem, don't he?
Yeah.
He got a problem, number one, because his problem, his plight affects His predicament affects, makes he has a problem. He's blind. That's his problem.
Mm-hmm.
He's outside the city.
Yeah.
That's his position.
Uh-huh.
And he's also by the wayside and he's begging.
Uh-huh.
Because he's blind, he had to beg. And because he's blind, he has to be by the wayside.
Yes.
Now watch this. Because of his predicament caused his problem.
Mm-hmm.
The only reason he's blind by the wayside is because he's blind.
Uh-huh.
His blindness led to his begging.
Uh-huh.
And his begging had him outside of the city.
Come on.
But wait a minute. He's blind.
Mm-hmm.
He's begging,
and
he's by the wayside, but he's in Jericho.
Yeah.
Jericho? Can I tell you, because that's his place.
Uh-huh.
And I'll tell you that there are sometimes your predicament can cause other problems.
Let me
make it practical. I know it don't happen here at your church, but some folks like to go to the boat.
Yeah.
Or like to go to Windstar.
Uh-huh.
Or Chop Top.
Yeah.
And they give all their money away.
Yeah.
And because they have to give all their money away, it affects other problems.
Uh-huh.
Now they got THU on your back.
Yeah, yeah.
They got Encore, and you can't pay your bills, and people call in talk about we get ready to let you go and all that stuff. Why? Because one predicament leads to other problems.
Yeah,
your blindness has caused you to beg.
Come on.
And your begging has caused you to be outside of the city.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. He's at Jericho. Now wait. Now Pastor Mitchell, I did a little study. I found out that Jericho is a low place.
Come on. Yeah.
Jericho, this place that he's in, is one of the lowest spots and places on earth.
Yeah.
It is 750 feet below sea level.
Come on.
He's a low place.
Uh-huh.
And I'm talking to somebody right now.
Yeah.
Come on.
You're in a bad place.
Come on. Sure.
I'm talking to somebody right now.
Yeah.
You got a lot of problems. I'm talking to somebody right now that you're in a predicament. But Mark in this text says, even though he's in a low place, even though he has some problem and he's in a bad predicament, the text says he's Bartimaeus.
Uh-huh.
This is person.
Yeah.
See, blind is an adjective, not a noun.
Uh-huh.
In other words, that describes him, but it doesn't define him.
Here
the problem is, our problem is, we let our description affect our identity.
Yes.
We think because we're begging that we don't have no honor, because we got a problem somehow that makes us connected with our identity.
Yeah.
In other words, if you got a problem with alcohol, you think that affects your identity. No, alcoholic is not who you are, it's what you have.
Come on.
Y'all ain't gonna help me today. Watch it. The addiction you have is not who you are, is what you have. The text says he's Bartimaeus. Watch this. Son of Timaeus.
Yeah.
Timaeus means to be honored.
Come on.
His name means, now wait a minute. Honor? I'm in a bad place.
Yeah.
That's why you gotta understand that's not who you are.
Come on now.
That's not just your description, your definition.
Yeah.
Come on. That's not connected. You are still honorable, and can I tell you, even honorable people find themselves in bad places.
Come on.
Even people that are having it all going on one time find themselves in a situation and a circumstance where things seem to look bad. But can I tell you, I don't care where your predicament is, I don't care what place you are, I don't care what problems you have, you are a good candidate for a holler. I got to show that to you. Watch this. Even though he's in a bad place, the text says that he hears that it's Jesus of Nazareth.
Yes.
He said there were some pastoral people that were going through that, and see, they're used to a lot of noise. But Bartimaeus notices that there's something different about the noise this time. He hears something, and even though he's blind, his hearing is okay. And here's what he does. He hears that it's Jesus of Nazareth. Stop right there. Because not only do we move from his problem and predicament, we now move to his plea.
Come on.
And look how his response is. When he hears that it's Jesus of Nazareth.
Yes.
Jesus of Nazareth, son of Jesus the Nazarene.
Mm-hmm.
Now, can I tell you that Jesus, I hate to bust y'all bubble today, Jesus is not an uncommon name. There's a lot of folk walking around named Jesus.
Yeah.
I was at school the other day. Talk to a Hispanic guy. His name was Jesus. Jesus. See, a lot of people walk around Jesus, but watch this. His plea is proper.
Come on.
Now, what you mean, Ron Fuller? It's a proper plea because he hollers, But he only hollers at Jesus, watch this, the Nazarene. Because then I found out I can make sure. Because there's a lot of folks hollering at Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
But they hollering at the wrong Jesus. I can't tell you, there's a lot of Jesus is gonna come around that you see on TV, and a lot of Jesus come around that's gonna be on the Word Network. A lot of Jesus gonna come around that's gonna be on the church channel. Some churches you go to have a lot of Jesus. Can I tell you, if you're gonna holler, if it's gonna be proper,
yeah,
you gotta holler at the right Jesus. Not Oprah's Jesus, not Malcolm X's Jesus, not Farrakhan's Jesus. He didn't holler at any Jesus. And can I talk to somebody today? The reason you're in a predicament you are and you can't get out of it is because you're hollering at the wrong Jesus.
Come on now.
When he hears that is Jesus the Nazarene, that's when he hollers. He hollered at my father. He hollered at the right person. I talked to my son the other day. My son sometimes helps me, like your son probably do, helps me with illustrations. I said, son, I got to preach. He said, I need to communicate the idea that you got to holler at the right person. I said, I need an illustration. My son's about 25 years old, and I said, hey, son, he's good at stuff like that. I need an illustration to communicate the idea of what it means to holler at the right person. He thought about it a little bit, and he said, okay, Dad, I got it. I said, what is it, something? I got to write it down. I got to preach for Mitchell, and Mitchell, you know, I use an extra hour to preach, so I know I got to come with something straight. He said, I got it, Dad. I said, what is it, son? He said, Dad, he said, I got a Sprint cell phone as my carrier. I said, got you. Yeah, I don't like Sprint, but whatever, good. He said, I got Sprint, and I was having some problems with my phone.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I said, I see where you're going. Okay, yeah, but you have a problem with your phone, whatever. He said, and I called the number to call him to see what I can do about fixing my phone. I said, I got you. He said, I called it, and he said, and I began to talk to them, and I tell him what's wrong with my phone and all this stuff. And so we spent a few minutes on the phone. And then he said, well, the lady operator said, well, what I need to do is I need to switch you to technical support.
Right.
I said, okay, now what's the problem? He said, Daddy, my problem was I was talking to the person that couldn't do nothing about my problem.
Come on, man.
And can I tell you something today? You are just like my son sometimes. You're talking to Jesus, can't do nothing about your problem, and you wonder why you're hollering and ain't got no help. It's because you're talking to somebody that's listening but can't help you. And can I tell you, if you're going to holler at somebody, you need to holler at somebody that's going to help you with your problem. If they're doing a whole bunch of guns and all that stuff, then excuse me, baby, switch me to technical support. Because I need somebody to help me. Look what he does. He hollers the right thing.
Yeah, he does. Yeah, he does.
Look at this. He said, Jesus, son of David.
Uh-huh.
In other words, he's saying, Jesus, I recognize you as the Messiah.
Yes.
Come on, man. Come on.
I know you're a miracle worker.
Uh-huh.
But I need more than that. I know that you can do all these things, but I need to recognize you as the Messiah. So he recognizes Jesus, and he recognizes his person, but he also recognizes his person. He said, Jesus, son of David.
Uh-huh.
And even though his theology ain't all, when he went to seminary and got all his degrees and stuff like that, but he recognizes something.
Mm-hmm.
He recognizes who Jesus is. Jesus, son of David, I know you came through the line of David. I know you're going to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I know you came to establish a kingdom. Jesus, son of David, watch this. Have mercy.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about y'all. But you know the one thing I need more than anything?
Yes, Lord.
Is the mercy of God.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
I need God's, not only God's grace,
yes,
to give me what I don't deserve.
Yes.
I need God's mercy.
Yes.
That holds back.
Yes.
What I do deserve.
Yeah.
And Ernie comes and says, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Now watch this. His plea is proper.
Mm-hmm.
Son of David. It recognizes who Jesus is, but not only is his plea proper, because it recognizes who Jesus is, but watch the text. His plea is also persistent.
Mm. Come on.
Now where did I get that from? It's right here in the text. You already tore it out of that. Watch this. He said, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy upon me." And watch this. And the people told him to shut up.
Come on.
Now, people that told him, don't be hollering at Jesus.
Yeah.
The people that told him, you need to be quiet.
Because
see, these Passover pilgrims, not only were they following Jesus, they were Jesus while he's going on the way would spend time teaching and preaching to the people.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And people wanted to hear what Jesus had to say, and Bartimaeus was making too much noise.
Uh-huh.
Doing all that hollering. He said, quiet down. Now watch this. Mark doesn't tell us, but I looked at the Bible, couldn't find it. I don't know if it's the crowd, the fans telling him to be quiet, or if it's the followers telling him to be quiet. In other words, I don't know if it's the crowd telling him to shut up, or it's other Christians telling him to shut up.
Yeah. Come on.
Now, I can understand the crowd telling him to shut up because they want to get something from Jesus.
Yeah. Come on.
But it bothers me that not only can it possibly be the crowd telling him to be quiet, it can also be other Christians telling him to be quiet.
Come on.
Other disciples telling him to shut up.
Yeah.
Now, that's not anything inconsistent. Do y'all remember the woman that had the one, this daughter that was grievously vexed with the devil, and she's following Jesus from coast to coast down to Tyre and Sidon? He said, "Jesus, have mercy on my daughter. She's grievously vexed with the devil." And it's not the crowd that tells her to be quiet. It's the disciples saying, "Send her away."
Yeah.
She's making too much noise.
Yeah, Lord.
That's not the crowd. That's not the disciples.
Mm-hmm.
Those are not the fans. Those are the followers.
Yeah.
And can I talk to somebody right now?
Go ahead.
You stop hollering because folk looked at you wrong. You stop hollering because some folk wouldn't let you do this in the church.
Yeah.
You stop hollering. He hollers out to Jesus. They told him to be quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And said, "Can I tell you something? You can't put stock in how folk treat you. You can't put stock and quit ministry. Won't get involved. Won't. In fact, I already decided to come out. I ain't going to kill though. I put in your mind. I ain't going out to do this evangelism. So I got something to do.
Yeah.
But no. But can I tell you? You got to be consistent and persistent." Because they didn't like your potato salad.
Yeah!
And let folks get you quiet there. He said, "Bartimaeus, no, I don't care what y'all say. I just an opportunity of a lifetime. Jesus ain't passing his way no more."
Yeah!
He followed by the wayside. He's powered out. And they tell him, "Quiet down."
Yeah.
Keep quiet.
Yeah.
And can I tell you why you ought not put stock in some followers? Because they wishy-washy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Some followers, they good one day and they bad the next. Some followers, they see like you hate to see them coming sometimes. You don't know what kind of mood they gonna be in. They switch up on you. I know what happened here at this church, but the churches I go to, you can never tell how folks gonna act and treat you. Can I show you in the text?
Yeah.
Because they told them to be quiet when Jesus says, who is it? Calls him. All of a sudden, the followers and the fans switch.
Come on now.
Look what it says. When Jesus calls on them, he said, bring it here, here's what happened. The fans all of a sudden switch.
Come on.
Now that I'm talking about take courage, he's calling for you.
Mm-hmm.
Now wait a minute. Y'all the same folk a few minutes ago were telling me to be quiet. Y'all the same folk a few seconds ago were telling me to shut up.
Yes.
Y'all the same folk a few minutes ago were talking about you don't take all it.
Yeah.
And now you all tell a sudden because Jesus is giving me attention.
Come on now.
Now you guys are trying to act like you all on my side. Can I tell you, that's how folks do sometimes.
Yeah.
They finicky, they wishy-washy.
Yeah.
Once they find out that Jesus is blessing you, and Jesus is giving you attention, all of a sudden, they want to jump on the bandwagon. And can I tell you, all of a sudden now, because Jesus is blessing you and giving you the job and healing you and doing miracles in your life, now all of a sudden they want to be your friend. Now all of a sudden they want to be your ace boom boom. Now they want to be your BFF. Because now Jesus is giving you attention.
Free.
You know what I'm saying? I don't care what y'all say.
Well said.
Jesus still cries out. The folks switch on him and say, get up. And here's what Jesus, here's what Bartimaeus does. He throws off, the text says, his cloak. Now why did Mark tell us that? Because what happened is if you're sitting by the wayside, you have a cloak. And what would happen, Sister Mitchell, is you undo that cloak, and as people and the passersby were coming, they would take the coins, and because they didn't want to touch you, they would throw their coins or their alms in your cloak, and at the end of the day,
yeah.
You would wrap up your cloak and take it with you, along with your money.
Yeah.
But Bartimaeus, when it came to getting an interview or a connection with Jesus, he throws off his cloak. Now wait a minute, that disturbed me because look at all that money he got.
Yeah.
It disturbed me, Bartimaeus, because what you going to do with that money?
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't concerned about that.
Come on now.
Because he knows that when he starts following Jesus, finance will be a problem. When he starts following Jesus, his needs are going to be met. When he starts following Jesus, because if he gets healed, he ain't got to be blind no more. He ain't got to be begging no more. He ain't got to be by the wayside. He'll be blind, he can get a job. And if he can get a job, he ain't got to beg. And if he got to beg, he ain't got to be by the wayside. He throws off his cloak, the text says, immediately.
Yeah.
In other words, he said, well, let me get myself together.
All right. Yeah.
He said, how I look? You ain't concerned about all that?
Yeah.
He got to, well, I got to do this first, and then I come to Jesus. He said, no, he stops where he are. Jesus stops the procession, calls out to him, said, bring him here.
Oh.
Bartimaeus throws off his cloak, jumped up, and came to Jesus. Now he's blind. He hears a voice of Jesus. He probably needs some help getting to Jesus.
Yeah.
And can I tell you, I know you all in the bag of chips.
Come on.
But there's somebody praying for you.
Yes, sir.
That helped you get to Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. When you were acting a fool out there in the street, doing all you can do, brother.
Yeah.
I wish I had somebody was praying for you.
Yeah.
because Jesus, when he gets there, Jesus asks him a question. He sees a man is blind. Because you were blind, because of the muscles in your eye, it would produce a lot of pus, so people could see that his eyes were messed up. And you could tell Jesus was blind, that Jesus knew that the man was blind. But Jesus asked him, what you want me to do? What you want me to do? What you mean, Jesus? Why are you asking this man? What does he want?
Come on, man.
You see the man blind, what do you think he want? You see the man hollering, what do you think he want? And you know what the Lord told me? He says, tell the church this. There's a lot of folks hollering, but really don't want no help. Because I know a lot of folks that do holler, but they don't want no help. They just holler. Let me hear my grandma. See, you were, we raise kids different now.
Yeah.
We need this old school rearing of children.
Tell it, doctor.
We make these people so weak and her little grandma used to do, because she would train people if you have a little baby on how to take care of the baby, what you need to do. And here's what my grandma would do. The baby would be hollering and crying and screaming. Grandma, I don't know what to do with the baby. He said, well, is the baby wet? Check the diaper. No. Ain't got no wet diaper. He said, did the baby use a bathroom on himself? No, he clean. He said, well, is it hungry? He said, no, grandmama, I just fed her. You know what grandma would say? Baby, that child just hollered. Let him alone. And can I tell you, we got some grown folk like that.
Yeah.
They holler, but don't want no help. Well, UPS is hiring. Oh, I don't want to do that. You just holler. Don't get mad at me. But there's a lot of folk here that just holler but don't want no help. I just problem make it ends me. Well, let me show you, baby, how you need to do a budget. I ain't got time for that. You just holler. Other blind man. He doesn't spit in the man's eyes like he did in the earlier part of the chapter.
Yeah.
In the Gospel of John, another man, and he spits and makes a mud pie and puts it on the eye of the blind man and says, go watch. In the pool of Siloam, he doesn't do that. He doesn't touch him. He doesn't spit in his eye. He doesn't anoint him at all. He don't lay hands on him. He fall out in the spirit. He don't do none of that stuff. He just says, go! Your faith has made you whole. Now watch this. Here's what I'm going to lose all my friends. Because, watch the text says he's made whole because of his faith. His faith. His theology wasn't all the way all that good, but he moves from a fan to be a follower.
Yes, sir.
Because of his faith. I know y'all gotta go, but can I just tell you one more thing?
Come on, God.
Not only see his plea was persistent, he got a problem. Uh-huh. He hollers out, his plea is persistent. His prize is that he's healed. But then he moves on and look at the text and look at his path. And he followed Jesus along the road. Now Mark doesn't tell us, but can I just share something with you what I believe? Mm-hmm. I believe Bartimaeus is still hollering.
Yes, sir.
But I believe he is hollering now. Not because he needs healing. He's hollering because he has been healed. Yeah. I believe he's hollering. To be delivered.